Good evening, Rowan. It's the 14th of May 2017 and it's about a quarter to eight. And obviously this is my usual Sunday evening video to reassure you I haven't been seducing any priests over the weekend, so you can relax. In fact, I haven't even seen any priests over the weekend, although I did very nearly see a completely null and utterly void Archbishop in Sheffield this morning. That's you on the screen there, actually, in Sheffield this morning. And I got as far as looking at the train timetables yesterday because I thought I might just turn up and arrest you. And obviously kick you in the balls as well with my steel toe caps if you tipped me the wink. And I could have clocked you as well if you'd wanted me to do that. So we missed out on that opportunity because my steel toe caps weren't polished. So I thought you'd be very disappointed if I turned up just in an ordinary pair of shoes and you wanted me to kick you in the balls. So that would have been disappointing. So I didn't want to disappoint you. So I didn't do that. So you don't know how close you came to being arrested this morning in Sheffield. Today could have been the day. So in addition to not seeing any completely null and utterly void archbishops, not seducing any priests over the weekend, I have also not been hanging around in the Catholic parish of St Urban's, hoping to bump into any pretend astrophysicists in order to save your skin, and not have I come out as a lesbian in order to save your gigantic ego. So that's probably quite disappointing for you as well, in addition to you missing out on the steel toe caps. So this evening, I thought we could continue our chat about the talk that you gave at the Teze event in Birmingham on the 30th of April, 2017, since that's the most recent lunacy now that's available on video on the internet. I did some more recent lunacy in my last video, but that was only a short video clip, so I've now reverted back to the next most recent lunacy, which is the 30th of April. So I'm going to finish off the last part of what you said in your talk there. I've covered nearly all of it, but there's still a bit at the beginning that I could talk about, which I missed out in order to go on to the most hilarious part of it first. So without further ado, I'm going to start to talk about that now. So this follows on immediately from where my last video on the subject ended. So you say, we as Christians have been given the most extraordinary gift of seeing the vision of the Jesus-shaped humanity. So I think gift, you're talking about give it to me, aren't you? And when you talk about Jesus-shaped humanity, this is just jargon. It doesn't really mean anything. But I think what you want it to mean is that I'm supposed to look at you and see Jesus. You're Jesus-shaped, in other words. And you've alluded to this in other talks that you've given, and I've spoken about it before. Because people like you don't even like people being devoted to God, do you? You have to be diverting that devotion towards yourself because you do in fact think that you are God. So, we as Christians have been given the most extraordinary gift of seeing the vision of the Jesus-shaped humanity that is God's long-term purpose for God's sons and daughters. Well, you haven't got anything along, have you? You've only got your microscopic floppy thing, but that might be what you're alluding to here, trying to pretend that it's long, when in fact it isn't. You're really hilarious. So this is God's purpose for me then, I suppose, and you're God anyway, but this is God's purpose for me, that I should look at you and see you as Jesus-shaped. Whereas in fact you're more Satan-shaped, aren't you? Because Jesus did say that he was the way and the truth and the life. And you never tell the truth, do you? You lie all the time. And Jesus also said that Satan was a liar and the father of lies. So you're really more Satan-shaped than Jesus-shaped, aren't you? So anyway, you say that this looking towards Jesus shaped humanity or whatever it is, which is God's long-term purpose for God's sons and daughters. You say, what a gift. So I think we're back on give it to me there, aren't we? What a gift. What a glory to see that. And part of the gift we're given then, so you keep mentioning gift and given, and part of the gift we're given is then the capacity to recognize that again and again and again, in the unfamiliar faces, in the new faces, the faces of others turn to God, the faces of people, God is already involved with, and you emphasize God is already involved with, which you also did earlier in this talk, and I talked about it before. So you're talking about Jesus-shaped humanity here, that God is already involved with people, and earlier in this talk you were emphasizing that human beings are created in the image of God, and all of this I think is driving in the direction that I'm supposed to look at you and see God. Which I've already explained. It's really a lot more look like looking at Satan, looking at you. You're really hysterically funny because you've rejected God, haven't you? And you're heading in the other direction in a furious rage. So you then say, how then could we not be committed? So you might be talking about being committed to a mental hospital there. How then could we not be committed to the building of friendship, deep friendship? You emphasise deep. There'd be nothing deep going on in relation to you, would there, with your microscopic floppy thing? How then could we not be committed to the building of friendship, deep friendship with those of other faith traditions? What you mean, like Luciferians, like you? How then could we not listen eagerly to what they have to say? Well, the reason I don't listen eagerly to what you have to say is that you talk crap all the time. You never say anything that isn't crap. Even if you say something that's actually true, it's only to prove in inverted commas, some bullshit that you're going to come out with later on. How then could we not listen eagerly to what they have to say? Hoping that our own understanding and love would grow because of it. You don't mean love, do you? You mean love. Well, my understanding of you is very good, Rowan. That's what you don't like. I understand you very well. You just want me to delude myself, that you're some kind of Christ substitute when actually you're just a madman and a scumbag. How then could we not listen eagerly to what they have to say, hoping that our own understanding and love would grow because of it? Well, you haven't got anything growing either, have you? So far from that being some kind of betrayal of Jesus. This is our understanding and love growing in relation to people of other faiths, but you really mean in relation to you, don't you? And you're a Luciferian, you're a Luciferian, rather. So I think what you're saying here, when you say so far from that being some kind of betrayal of Jesus, emphasizing betrayal, I think you're trying to tell me that it being involved with you in a sexual sense and prostituting myself, committing adultery, which would both be a betrayal of Jesus or of Christian teaching, anyway. This wouldn't be a betrayal of Jesus, because this is really what God wants. And you're God anyway, aren't you? So God obviously wants exactly what you want. So far from this being as some kind of betrayal of Jesus, that is surely part of how we enter more deeply into the life of the one we believe to be the living universal word. Well, I don't think you're going to be entering more deeply, but you're speaking astrophysically here, aren't you? So you've got a microscopic floppy thing, and he's definitely got tiny feet as well. Plus, he's a creepy old git just like you. And in any case, I'm saving myself for my beloved because he's so wonderful and we're made for each other. So I've already got a lover, Rowan. So you're really barking up the wrong tree if you think in you're going to divert my attention away from a wonderful, handsome, gorgeous, sexy man like that over to a creep like you or your pretend astrophysical perverted clergy friend. So far from that being some kind of betrayal of Jesus, that surely is part of how we enter more deeply into the life of the one we believe to be the living universal word. So you're speaking astrophysically, and also life and living refers to the satsang, doesn't it? Where it says, "You make my body come alive." So you then emphasize God's face turned towards us. So you're talking about the missionary position there again, aren't you? You're such a creep, it's unbelievable. So you then say, in this multiple, difficult, conflict-ridden world we inhabit. So I don't know what a multiple world is. I think you've just stuck that in because you think it sounds good. Or maybe you're talking about the statistical probability of all your clocks saying 9/11. In this multiple, difficult, conflict-ridden world we inhabit, well, it wouldn't be so difficult and conflict-ridden if you weren't such a scumbag, would it? And if you weren't lying all the time and deliberately destroying people's lives, slandering them all over the place, and providing propaganda that leads to wars being started and hundreds of thousands of people being murdered and displaced. So, without you, it would be a lot less difficult and conflict-ridden, wouldn't it? In this multiple, difficult, conflict-ridden world we inhabit, we need, above all, habits of friendship and of profound listening. So you keep talking about habit here, mentioning habits. So I think that might be related to the garment that a monk or nun wears, which is called a habit. And you are at this Teze event, and Teze is a community of brothers of monks, and they wear habits. At least in the church, they do anyway. So that might be what you're referring to there. We need, above all, habits of friendship and profound listening. So I don't know why the words profound and listening go together. But I think you're using the word profound for emphasis and to try and convey to the people listening that you're saying something profound when in fact it's just your usual impressionistic bullshit. And anyway, I'm listening very well to you and I'm commenting on what you're actually saying. I'm not making things up the way that you do when you say Jesus says things that he never said and then you make up lies about other people as well. So, in this multiple, difficult, conflict-ridden world we inhabit, we need, above all, habits of friendship and profound listening. We need to show our world that what animates us in our faith, in our one Lord Jesus, is hope, not fear, reaching out, not closing doors. So you're talking about legs here, aren't you? Not doors. So I need to show the world that I'm going to prostitute myself to you. That's going to help everybody, is it? What a lot of nonsense. When Jesus Christ rises from the dead, so you're talking about rising here. I'm not too sure that you're talking about Jesus Christ rising from the dead. You might be talking about something else rising, which is far less likely to rise than someone to rise from the dead, to be quite honest. When Jesus Christ rises from the dead, his identity, his humanity fills the whole universe. Wherever we turn, there he is. So I think you're once again trying to get me to look at you and look at your pretend astrophysical perverted clergy friend as if they were Christ, as if you were Christ. Well, it really isn't going to happen because you both lie all the time and you're both complete scumbags. So you both look a lot more like Satan than like Christ. So When Jesus Christ rises from the dead, his identity, his humanity, fills the whole universe. Wherever we turn, there he is. Well, that just frankly isn't true, is it? There's a lot of very un-Christ-like things going on and very un-Christ-like people about, and you're certainly one of them. So you then quote a poem by Gerald Manley Hopkins, which is called As Kingfishers Catch Fire. And this is actually referring to Christ, and this is the quotation: lovely in eyes, lovely in limbs, not his. So if you look at this poem, it is talking about seeing Christ in the faces of other people. So what that means is you're supposed to treat other people in an ethical way, you know, feed them if they're hungry and that kind of thing, and not launch smear campaigns behind their back and not have them murdered in illegal wars, that kind of thing. That's what it means when about seeing Christ in other people, if Christians are encouraged to see Christ in other people or act as Christ for people, to act in a serving and self-sacrificial way. So it doesn't mean that you should be worshipping and adoring disgusting perverts, psychopaths, and indulging their narcissistic delusions. So that's not what it means in Christian teaching, and I'm quite sure it isn't what Gerald Manley Hopkins means in his poem either. So, lovely in eyes, lovely in limbs, not his, as the great poet Hopkins said. In our searching, let's keep looking for that loveliness, expecting the surprise revelation of a face turned to God, the gift that comes from another human being with whom God is already involved. And that's where your talk ends there, and then the worship carries on after that. So you're talking about a gift again here, aren't you? Give it to me. Another human being with whom God is already involved. Well, you are another human being with whom God is already involved, but unfortunately, you've decided to reject God and follow the way of Satan and treat other people in a sadistic, cruel way, which certainly isn't following the way of God and the way of Christ. So, as I've said, when I look towards you, you have more in common with Satan than with Christ, unfortunately, because you're such a scumbag. Anyway, that's the end of what I'm going to say about this talk that you gave at this Tese event on the 30th of April. But I am going to say a couple of words about something else after I've showed this video footage of you giving this talk.
We need a level of habits of friendship and of profoundness. We need to show to our world that what animates us in our faith in our one Lord Jesus is hope, not fear. Reaching out, not closing doors.
If you love me, love me, love me, I'll drive you crazy.
Reaching out, not closing doors.
Give it up.
Reaching out, not closing doors. When Jesus Christ rises from the dead, when Jesus Christ rises from the dead, his identity, his humanity, fills the whole universe.
Extraterrestrial.
when Jesus Christ rises from the dead, his identity, his humanity, fills the whole universe. Wherever we turn, there he is.
I'm the devil in a black dress, watches over. My guardian angel walks the way. Life is short and love is always over in the morning. Black wind, come carry me far away.
When Jesus Christ rises from the dead, his identity, his humanity, fills the whole universe. Wherever we turn, there he is. Lovely in eyes. Lovely in eyes, lovely in limbs, not his, as the great poet Hopkins said. In our searching, let's keep looking for that loveliness, expecting the surprise revelation, the face turned to God, the gift that comes.
Give it to me, baby, like boom, boom, boom.
The gift that comes.
Oh! Oh, yes! 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 Oh! Yes! 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 Oh! Oh! Oh!
I'll have what she's having.
The gift that comes from another human being with whom God is already involved.
And the devil in a black dress watches over.
The gift that comes from another human being with whom God is already involved. The gift that comes from another human being with whom God is already involved.
Did you say, oh, you're breaking up on me? Sorry, I cannot hear you, I'm kind of busy.
So I thought I could make a couple of extra comments about the lecture that you gave at Norwich Cathedral on the 8th of May 2017. I only had the very short video clip filmed by the audience member when I made my last video about it, and since then an article about it has been published on the Network Norfolk website, and the reporters made some quotations in that article of other things that you said. I don't want to go through all of them, but I am going to just make a comment on one or two of the quotations from that lecture. So here's the first one. Dr. Williams said that these activities are sacramental. So the activities that you're referring to here, and they relate to Christian Aid Week, the activities are praying, giving, collecting, and putting on fundraising events. That's all detailed in the previous paragraph of this article. So Dr. Williams said that these activities are sacramental and carry the energy of God's connecting purpose. So you're using the term connecting here, and in a recent video, and I've talked about this before, I told you that connectedness wasn't a word, and the word that you were looking for was connection. And since then, you've been using the word connect, connecting, connection, an awful lot in the things that you've been saying. And secondly, I've talked about your use of the word energy before, and you're relating this energy to God. And I'd previously said, I've said this in many videos, in fact, that I'd described the energy that David Pete had in his constant harassment of me and imagining different ways of doing this. The energy behind that, I said, I viewed as satanic. And I said this in a letter that I wrote complaining about him. And it was in response to that letter that I was thrown out of the church. So you've constantly tried to associate energy with God and godly people as if that's going to change my opinion of David Peake's behaviour. And talking about God's connecting purpose here, you're trying to imply, aren't you, that it's God who's trying to connect you to me. Well, you think that you are God, so it's you who's trying to connect you to me. And I'd like to know how you've arrived at the conclusion that God wishes you and I to be connected, because I don't share that view. So anyway, this sort of action states what we believe to be most real. So I guess you're supposed to be talking about praying, giving, collecting and putting on fundraising events in Christian Aid Week. But I think you're actually talking about the energy of God's connecting purpose, aren't you? And this connection or connectedness is the kind of action. What could you mean by action? States what we believe to be most real. So it's me who's been unrealistic and refusing to have anything to do with you. And it's not you being unrealistic, thinking that you're God and that you're in control of everything and everyone in the universe. Well, I'm glad we've got that cleared up then. So Dr. Williams said we must speak and act as if what is real is what is mutual. So I've been unrealistic in not wanting to have anything to do with a psychopathic scumbag who keeps threatening to rape and kill me and who has had my life destroyed just because he can't take no for an answer. You're really hilarious. And I think you're referring to this Jesus Jones song again, aren't you? Real, real, real. Because you're Jesus Williams, obviously, being the Messiah and being Welsh. Dr. Williams said we must speak and act as if what is real is what is mutual. He spoke of a pressure towards isolation and the attitude that it is too complicated to take responsibility for our neighbours. Well, the pressure towards isolation, Rowan, you've put the pressure on me towards isolation, haven't you? By isolating me from everyone else in order to try and force me to involve myself with you and your perverted pretend astrophysical clergy friend. So I've been isolated by other people. That wasn't my choice. And it's true I am avoiding people more than I normally would because I can't go out because of gang stalkers everywhere. So it's other people that have put this pressure of isolation on me at your behest. So that's the pressure towards isolation. But bad luck, because I'd rather be isolated than have anything to do with satanic filth like you. And then, this is my favourite bit actually, he posed the challenge, what if refusal is unrealistic? You really are so funny. Well, too bad if refusal is unrealistic, Rowan, I'm still refusing. So I'm only commenting on one sentence from these couple of paragraphs here. The last sentence, the connecting work of God continues whatever we do to frustrate or ignore it. So I have said quite often that you do actually think that you're God, don't you, and the universe revolves around you. So this connecting work, and we've got this use of the word connect again, and as I said, I've recently spoken in a video about you making up words like connectedness. So you've used this word connect quite a lot recently. So you're doing the connecting work, aren't you? And this is the work of God in your narcissistic delusions, connecting yourself with me. Whereas in reality, you're just having fantasies about me and you can't understand that this isn't the real world and it simply isn't going to happen. The connecting work of God continues whatever we do to frustrate or ignore it. And so you're feeling frustrated because I'm not doing what you want, no matter how many tantrums you throw and how often you stamp your foot, because I'm not your mother and I'm not giving in to you. I'm setting appropriate boundaries because you're fixated in a state of infancy and you're incapable of doing that for yourself. And this reference to ignoring this alleged connecting work of God, which is actually your fantasies, is referring to the clip of a toddler throwing a tantrum that I use quite often in my videos, and a voice in the background saying, ignore him, ignore him. So your connecting work, by which you mean your narcissistic delusions that I'm going to somehow be involved with you one day, simply because you've decided that that's so. So this connecting work of God continues whatever we do to frustrate or ignore it. That's really hilarious. Well, you carry on with your connecting work, God, and I'll carry on frustrating and ignoring it. So I'll leave it there for this evening, because obviously I want to be going to sleep as soon as possible so I can be dreaming about my beloved all night long, because he's so wonderful and we're made for each other and we just can't wait to be together in each other's arms, having a really good time on our bed of roses and our silk sheets. We're really, really excited about it. We're looking forward to it so much. We just can't wait till you're out of the picture. And I bet your wife can't wait till you're out of the picture as well, so she can be having a good time with her Rastafarian boyfriend. So I'm just going to read this sentence again. The connecting work of God continues whatever we do to frustrate or ignore it. Hasta la próxima.
Ignore it.
Live the World Trade, long live the King, yo, I'm from the Empire State. That's
both hands. And late that night when the Lord came home inquiring of his lady, oh. The servant said on every hand, she's gone with the raggle-taggle gypsies, oh.
The footman analyzed the number, but the prince still holds both the slippers. And would you leave a palace for a bed, sits and cats of retails?
Oh, what care I for my house and my land? What care I for my money? Oh, I'd rather have a kiss from the wild gypsy's lips. I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy.
With the raggle-taggle gypsy.
With the raggle-taggle gypsy. I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy. Oh.